from San Francisco, California, this is the Rock and Roll Geek Show.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. My name is Michael Butler. Thanks a lot for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today is Monday, August 6th, 2018, and it is day six of the Dog Days of Podcasting, where I'm attempting to do a show a day for the entire month of August, as you well know. All right, so I have asked for submissions to get me through this month, and I got an email from Paul Houston. Hi, Paul. How you doing, friend? Hope you're well, Michael. You asked a suggestion for a content on your show or Dog Day shows. As a longtime listener, I have never heard the full story of how you joined Exodus, how you got the audition, how you found out about it, your mindset going into it, how many songs you had to learn, the audition process, how you found out you got the gig, rehearsals, first day of tour, how you got on with the rest of the band, some tour stories, and how it all ended. The whole story. I know you've mentioned you don't like talking about yourself, but I think all of your listeners would love this story, or are you saving it for the book? Your friend, Paul Houston. Stay frosty. Oh, thanks, Paul, for the email. All right. Hold on. I got earbuds here that are clanking around, so I'm doing this on Boss Jock, so hold on a second here. Let me get this. All right. I'm going to be cleaning up dog poop in the backyard while I try to relate this. I need to find some. I just walked in from work on my lunch break, so I'm going to find some stuff to clean up dog poop out of the backyard. All right. Well, Paul, all right, I'm going to try to tell you as much as I can remember. I am writing a book, but I haven't worked on it in about 2 years because I'm kind of losing confidence in my writing abilities, and I don't want to really put out a crappy book, you know, so I put it on hold. It's looking now like if somebody doesn't help me with this book, as in, you know, like all the guys do who tell stories to somebody else and they write the book for them, if somebody didn't write this book for me, it's a good chance it's not going to get written, but you never know. I might decide to get back into it. We'll see. Let me put this, see if I can put this phone in my pocket without it turning off. I hope it doesn't while I clean up poop. So, the way I got into Exodus, I moved out to San Francisco with a band called Stevie Stiletto. We were a punk rock band from Florida. And we had a way of kind of like burning bridges wherever we were. So we kind of like burnt our final bridges in Jacksonville, where we were from, and decided to make the trek to California. We had lived in, or we had journeyed to Indianapolis, Indiana. We've journeyed to New York City and Atlanta, Georgia. Figured we'd go ahead and make the journey to California. And we moved to California and played here for a few years until we finally got tired of spinning our wheels and something happened where we broke up. Anyway, so I was playing in bands after that, and this guy who used to come to Stevie Stiletto shows named Danny DeWald, Stuttering Danny was his nickname because he stuttered a lot. He has a cable access show called Reality Check TV. He's pretty active in the metal scene. And he was a fan of Stevie Stiletto. And he called me up one day and said, hey, this metal band called Exodus is looking for a bass player. Would you like me to get you in touch with their manager, Tony Isabella? And I said, sure, because I was playing in, you know, some other local bands, but I was always open to find something that was, you know, doing a little bit more. And Exodus was on Capitol Records. I knew that much. I didn't really know much about the band Exodus, except I had heard of them, and I saw them on the cover of BAM Magazine, which was the big local music magazine in San Francisco. So I knew of the band, but didn't really know their music too well. I knew they were a thrash metal band. So I said, sure, I would like to pursue this. So he gave me Tony's number. She worked for Bill Graham Management. And I called her, and she said, okay, we'll set up an audition for you in 2 weeks. And at that time, I was getting ready to go out to back to Florida to visit my mom and my stepdad with my daughter Martina, who had just been born like a like less than a year before that. This was, I think, 1991 or something like that. And so Martina was like, you know, a year old or something like that. And my parents hadn't really seen their grandchild. So I was planning on going out to visit my mom so she could see her granddaughter. Anyway, so she gave me, so Tony said, okay, we'll have auditions in this at this certain date. And you need to learn these four songs. What songs were they? It was one of them was Brain Dead, I think, Toxic Waltz, and then two other ones which were I could not tell you for the life of me what songs they were. Maybe Piranha or something like that. I don't know. There were four Exodus songs. Those are the only two I remember. Let me see if I can remember this now. Danny made me a tape, a cassette, that's right. Danny ran me off a cassette of those Exodus tunes. And I brought them with me to Florida. I brought my bass with me. And I believe I brought a little practice amp. I may not have brought an amp. Anyway, that's not important. So I practiced these songs while I was visiting my parents in Florida for, I don't know, I think I was there for a week or something like that. Practice and listen to the songs a million times. Then it came time to audition. I had a 1966 Ford Galaxy 500 that I was driving, and the auditions were at their practice space, which was in Oakland. And I drove up to the place. I got there about 30 minutes early, and I was listening at the door to other people, because they were having cattle call auditions. They had a bunch of people auditioning, apparently. And I sat outside the door and listened, and I got scared and drove away and contemplated not doing it, just blowing the audition off. Then I thought to myself, you know, dude, if you don't do this, you're going to hate yourself for the rest of your life. So just turn your ass around and go play these songs for this band. So I did that. I knock on the door. Let's say the audition was at 1 o'clock p.m. or something like that. I remember calling in sick to work. I was painting for this company called Classic Shades Painting. I told them, I called in sick for some reason, which I never did. Pardon me, I'm taking a sip of this fine iced tea. So I turned around, went there, knocked on the door like 1 o'clock in the afternoon. I remember walking in and Rick Hunolt, the guitar player, goes, "He's got the chin! Look!" And I didn't really know what that meant at the time, but apparently my chin is the most noticeable part of my body, I guess. And he said, "He's got the chin!" And they all looked, and yeah, you're right, dude! And everybody was really nice to me. Gary came and greeted me, shook my hand, and they had an amp set up for me. I brought in my guitar. I think I was playing, at that time my main bass was like a 1973 Gibson, or not, a 1973 Fender Tele bass. I hope you're into this story, so it might be a little bit long. So, walk in there with my Tele bass. They're looking at my bass. "Oh, cool bass," and you know, they're talking like that. And met John Tempesta, Rick Kuhnholt, Gary Holt, and John Tempesta was on drums, and Zetro. And we plug in, played the first song. I did it pretty well, flawless. I mean, there was the thing about Exodus tunes, if you listen hard to the Exodus songs, the guitar parts are really complicated. But if you listen to the bass, Rob McKillop was the bass player who was there before me, the original Exodus bass player. I guess he's the original. He was there before me, and I thought he was a cool bass player, but listen to the Exodus songs, and the bass is kind of just playing the root note, just driving the root note and picking it like along with the double bass, and the guitars are ones that's playing the hard stuff. So I just made sure that I watched John Tempesta and stayed on the kick drum and the snare, and if I had any problems, ride the root note. So I made sure I kept it as solid as hell. I had my bass swung super low, which they thought was really cool. Finished the first song, and Zetcher goes, "Great vibe, man. We got a really good vibe from you." And I said, wow, that's great. And so played the rest of the songs. Everything seemed to go good. And I left there feeling really good about myself, feeling really good about the audition. I think Tony was there. Tony Isabel, the manager. I think she was there because they were having a cattle call. And I remember the guy before me, he played one song and then they threw him out. So, which one of the reasons I got kind of nervous. And anyway, got a good vibe. I got called back for another audition. Tony called me like 3 days later to let me stew on it for a little while. But I left there thinking I did pretty well. And Tony called me like 3 days later and after letting me stew for a few days, and said, everybody liked you, but we want you to learn two more songs or so many more. These new songs, I don't remember, for the life of me, I can't remember which songs they wanted me to learn, but I learned those two songs, made it through like one of those songs, and they just said, "Dude, sounds great, thanks, man." And I don't even know if I played the second song. I think we might have, and we might even played all the other songs that I auditioned the first week as well. Went well. I had Martina's child seat in the back of my car, and Zetro said, "Oh, you got a kid." And I'm thinking, is this going to cause me to not get a gig in the band? Because they were still on Capitol Records at this time. Is this going to cause me not to, because I have a kid, maybe I can't tour? I said, "Yeah, I have a daughter, but it won't affect me touring in the band or anything like that. So you wouldn't have anything to worry about that." They go, "Oh, it's cool, man. We all got kids too." So that was good. Tony asked me questions, but you know, reservations they had, and would I be interested in helping write and this and that. And of course I said, "Oh yeah, I write metal songs. Hell yeah, no problem." And then a week later, they wanted me to meet them at this place called, it might have been Mel's Diner, somewhere in the financial district. And they presented me with a black denim jacket that said Exodus, and it had this cartoon guy. They had apparently had a mascot just like all the other metal bands. I don't know what their mascot guy was called. He kind of disappeared quickly, but they presented me with this denim Exodus jacket, which I still have. It was an embroidered denim Exodus jacket. I still have it somewhere in my closet. It's a little bit big. I think it belonged to Zetra or something like that. Zetra's the singer. So they said, you're in the band, dude. And I was happy as hell. I could not be more happier. And they were on Capitol. So Tony says, let me know how much money you need. You know, what your bills are, we'll pay your bills. And here's a tape of the new album we're going to be recording, that you need to learn all these songs. Listen to them for about 2 weeks, and then we'll start rehearsing them, because we're going to go in the studio in London, England. Chris Tangarides is going to be producing it, who produced Tigers of Pangtang, Concrete Blonde, Judas Priest, The Great Thin Lizzy. I knew of Chris Tangarides, and I knew of all these bands that he produced, and I was like, wow. So I told him how much my bills were, so they paid my bills. So all my expenses were, you know, all my bills were covered by the band, which at that time it was my rent and my utilities and, you know, stuff like that. So I kept my job. I told my boss that I was only going to work 2 days a week, because I had 3 days, I was practicing 3 days a week with Exodus, and that was it. I was in the band, and I was going to England, motherfuckers, to play with the Great Exodus. By then, you know, I didn't know Exodus, but by then, to me, they were the Great Exodus, because I was on a major label. I went from being in a punk rock band to being in the Great major label band Exodus on Capitol Records, getting ready to record their second Capitol Records album. All right, I think I should probably make this a part one, because we're already 15 minutes into this, so I won't make it too long. I'll come back tomorrow with part two. What do you think about that? Is that okay with you guys? I hope so. Tonight, I'm going to Ace Frehley. And Ralph Miller, friend of the show, gave me a ticket to the Ace Frehley show. So I'm going to be driving to Berkeley to see Ace Frehley at the Cornerstone, which is where the Butlers are playing on Thursday with LA Guns. So I'll come back and give you a short review of that later on this week, too. Tomorrow, I guess I'll do part two of the Exodus story tomorrow. If I don't get to that, maybe I'll do the Ace Frehley review tomorrow and then Wednesday do Exodus part two. We'll see. I still have a lot more to go. Like recording in England, first gig, first tour, other tours, going to Japan, the band getting dropped from Capitol Records, all this, okay? So more to come. I hope you enjoyed that. Back with part two tomorrow or the next day. This was day six of the Dog Days of Podcasting. I'm sitting here petting my beautiful little dog, Stella. All right, I might as well close out with an Exodus tune. How about that? Thank you, friends, for listening to these daily Dog Days episodes. I hope you're into them. I try not to take too much time out of your day. And if you want to find out more about all the shows who are doing the Dog Days of Podcast, go to dogdaysofpodcasting.com. I'll talk to you tomorrow. Thanks for the donations. Without your donations, this show would die a horrible, putrid, stench-filled death. You can find where to donate at rockandrollgeek@rockandrollgeek.com. Email me, rockandrollgeek@gmail.com. Please keep the show reviews and show suggestions coming. I'll close out with an Exodus song from the album that I'm on, which is called Force of Habit. This is Thorn in My Side. We'll talk to you tomorrow, friends.
That you never gave me a chance to prove myself. It's a rock and roll geek train wreck.